answer the question.
Just doing the math quickly, I guess it looks like about $31,000 administration fees that the city will pay over the life of two bonds. This amendment has no effect on principal.
I understand that, I just want to be for the record clear in the minutes down the road, where we're really clear what the cost is. And do you know if there's a penalty or not?
That I don't know.
And that's important also, to pay that early, to avoid this administrative costs as well as the interest. After that clarification, council wants to approve that bond.
I'll make a motion.
Don, move the, take the, as published, the clarification, report on the IGA between the city and the club.
Give me a second. More discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Westover?
Yes.
Councilor Warren?
Yes.
Councilor Baker?
Yes.
Councilor Snyder?
Yes.
Councilor Shum?
Yes.
Councilor Stonewood?
Yes.
Thank you. And for the month of under new business, regarding pool and permit, right? Thank you, that.
Somebody flag number one?
Okay, no. So under new business pool employment agreement for the planning director, does this speak to that with Ray, or want me to speak to the guys?
Well, actually, Mayor, I was going to ask, maybe summer days, Chair, the planning director, I'll speak to that.
Really love to have you address it.
Maybe summer days.
Chair, planning commission director.
Six or one vice president, chairman of the planning commission. I don't have, I obviously have not seen the contract or any of that information, but I did participate in the interviews with,
There are two phone interviews and one face-to-face, right?
Two phone interviews and then one face-to-face here, and then I did meet with him on Saturday following two, where I met his wife, which I was very impressed with what he knew about Oregon, and I recommend that we go through and try to get him as a city planner. For a couple of reasons. Number one, I think we're going to have a difficult finding someone else with the Oregon experience that he has, that he's familiar, he's worked in the system in Oregon. He had great credentials as far as academic credentials. I didn't bring any of that stuff with me because I didn't know I was going to be asking that of me, but so he does have, he may have a master's, I can't remember. I think he had a master's.
He has a master's in urban planning.
In urban planning. I was very impressed with him when especially Saturday when we met in a more casual situation and talked about a lot of different things. So I would highly recommend that we don't let grants pass getting and we get.
He did interview with Grant Pass also.
He did interview with Grant Pass at the same time he interviewed with us. So I have no idea, but I think we should move quickly because if we don't get him, then we've got to go through the expense and process of trying to find another one. And that's just going to take time. We've only got our wonderful city manager for 6 months, so we start pushing into that where we're I just encourage you. I felt very good and felt the planning commission could work with him well.
Yeah, I just want to add that based on the input received from the interview panel and other people who spoke to him, we did tender a conditional offer to him, which he has accepted, the condition, of course, is that as an interim city manager, I cannot hire or dismiss anybody. So his title would have to be approved by the city council. He is aware of that fact, and...
So we did say that if it gets approved, that he has accepted?
Yes, he accepted the condition of the council approval.
Pardon me?
It would be.
Well, he's in Reno. He doesn't live here.
He is available by phone. If the council would like to speak to him by phone, so...
Let me also let the, sorry, the Ray also interviewed and he could go to us. Did you want to say a few words about?
Jim also.
Jim was there also. So we've had a pretty good cross-section in the city. We've done 3-4 interviews with them. Everyone's unanimous.
You can't bombard him with everybody, so it has, so we had Jim from the city council represent and...
I might add, I did also have an interview with him with Ray and went through, of course, my background, so as you know, planning commission as well as being on the council. I was very impressed, and mostly he had a lot of energy, and he really wants the challenge. So this is the character he here sees as an opportunity. Any planner that's worth their salts, he puts here in Phoenix, he jumped at it. He's very positive, and he has a lot of experience. He's been a good planner in many cities.
And just to respond to you, Terry, too, I think traditionally a city council wouldn't even be looking at this kind of hire. It would traditionally be a city manager, but since we just have an interim, that's the only reason we're even looking at it.
We're under a lot of scrutiny for high employee turnover.
Yeah, we are.
And voting for someone that I've never met or even seen a picture of is a challenge for me. Nothing against them, it's just we're held to account for how well they work out. And if I've never got to meet him, that's not fair to either me, to him, to the city, or people that...
Who checked on that?
You might just have to trust your planning chairman.
Oh, I know, we're working on this trust thing. It's mutual though, right?
Well, I've been here a lot of years, and I've seen a lot of city councils come and mayors come and go and...
It looked like you had pretty extensive references. Did you guys call on us?
Yes.
We talked with references.
We checked out. There were, I'll be really upfront, there were some issues in Baker City where he was let go, which in our first phone interview with him, he had informed us that he had been let go, that he had taken that job and was not qualified for it and should not have been in that position. And the reason he had taken it is because he had worked in Baker County before and really enjoyed that and wanted to get back there.
And that was in 04, it looked like.
Yeah.
So it's 12
years. So that was an issue, and then there was an issue, and I'll be really upfront and frank. The issue that he had in Pendleton was a positive for me, because he got into, there was a sign ordinance, and he got into it with the Pendleton Roundup, putting up a sign that didn't meet any of the ordinances, and he bumped heads with them and said, you need to follow what the statutes say, and they said, we don't care. So I don't think they fired him or anything. He just said, this is a mutual problem that I'm not going to cross.
So. And we did make arrangements tonight, to Terry's point. We can talk to him. We can get him on the hall right now. You chat with him a little bit. You want to chat with him?
Well,
that's fine. Let's get him on the phone.
Yeah, dial him up.
You have in your packet, don't you, his resume?
Yeah, we do.
His resume is pretty impressive.
I was really impressed, and if we do not get him, we got an expense to the city that we need to consider to go fishing again for somebody else, and the odds are that we're going to get somebody in the state of Oregon that understands the Oregon nuances.
You understand my concern?
I absolutely do. I absolutely do. I just want to tell you where I'm coming from. I mean, I've been through probably 15 planners since I've been here. 10. Oh, I don't think so. I mean, you go back to Dennis Murray, and we have a lot.
I'm becoming a connoisseur of planner.
Ray, you had something to say?
It's a great job.
Yeah, actually, I've been involved in the process for a month and a half now, and been through the initial stages of the reviews of the different resumes and getting input on even before we made the phone interviews with him. And he's a very sincere guy. I like what Mickey said in her take on the Pendleton issue, with a guy that has rules and sees rules and regulations, they won't back down. There's an awful lot of political pressure associated with the biggest gun in town, and he just, you know, stayed with his convictions because he is very, very admirable. That's the kind of presence that I think that she wants in a growing town, and a town that's going to look to presumably expand in the next several years. So that kind of order and that kind of recognition of the order block is very, very important in the position coming into us. I also believe the high energy aspect is very important. Bruce noted, I brought him around to see the different folks in town and the different areas that we're looking to develop to give them a flavor of the community, since it is rather unique, and trying to show them the areas where we're looking at some of our urban reserve expansion. And I think that's a real good point that Bruce made. If you're a planner and you see this on the horizon for a small town, you ought to be excited. And he was excited about that. I think that's a very, very attractive aspect to why he would want to come here. And I think that the environment fits him very well. He's a bicycling enthusiast. He will be a strong multimodal presence in our community, I'm sure of that. And he recognizes the value of the greenway as something that's extremely important to somebody who recognizes the need for that interconnectivity. So there are a lot of really unique aspects to the community that I think attract the guy and his character and his background. So he really impressed me as an intelligent, well-spoken, and also very sincere individual. And I think he'd be a great asset to the community. So that was my recommendation to Dave and to Mickey as well.
I'm comfortable with that.
One more thing that he said that he was coming back to Oregon because he wants to spend the rest of his life in one place and he's not moving on. And so he really tried to emphasize that I'm not going to be somebody that comes and leaves. This is my final landing spot, which, I mean, some people are climbing the ladder, and I think he's at a point in his life where he wants stability in his ladder. So.
Thank you for adding that piece. That's helpful.
He's an Oregon guy who wants to be in Oregon. The move to Reno was for certain personal issues with medical responsibilities he had with he and his wife, and he wants to be in Oregon, and clearly from his resume, he needs to be in Oregon.
Thanks. Looks like he spoke Spanish also.
Yeah, he speaks Spanish.
That's great.
Yeah, that's cool.
So I guess there's someone in the audience who wants to speak to this particular agenda item. So, Mickey, would you grab your seat for a minute? Let somebody.
Oh, sure.
Okay, cool.
Does anybody have any questions for me?
If you're happy with him, I know he's got to be good.
Well, I love the city of Phoenix, so I think he'll be a great asset for him.
Who was it that wanted to speak to this item? Ken, did you want to? No? Anybody?
I think she wanted 9B.
I was trying to get added for 9B and C.
Not A. That was my fault.
Okay. That's it.
Before the council votes, I want to note, as Councilor Snyder pointed out, in 1.3.1, it says except as stated herein during her employment. Obviously, it should be his employment. That's just a Scrivener's error. It does not require council action to bring that in.
I had a chance to meet Evan twice too at work, and he's very easy to talk to, which I appreciate about him. And I really liked his wife a lot. She was a gem. So it's nice to have him alongside.
I'll add something else. So Stefan also was in part of that. He's very happy with having him as his boss also, which is very important.
Thanks.
Well, I'm also really impressed by his resume. I haven't met him, so I'm ready to make a motion to move to offer employment as agreed in the agreement for employment as planning director, City of Phoenix, Oregon, to Evan McKenzie.
I would also amend that to include that the city man, interim city man, has signed a contract along with the mayor.
Great.
Because he doesn't have the authority unless we give it to him.
So do we have to vote on the amendment and then on the original motion?
No, I'm just adding that informally to your amendment. So before we give a second, we don't have to change it.
Okay, so I'll amend my motion to include that language.
Right, thank you. And I'll second.
So let's go ahead and read the motion.
Thank you.
Okay, so, do you want to restate the motion?
So I made the motion. So I move to offer employment as agreed in the agreement for employment as planning director, City of Phoenix, Oregon, to Evan McKenzie. And we would also like to have the city manager sign on to that contract.
Sign. Okay.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'd second.
Okay. Roll call.
Councilor Warren?
Yes.
Councilor Baker?
Yes.
Councilor Snyder?
Yes.
Councilor Shunk?
Yes.
Councilor Westover?
Yes.
Councilor Sophie?
Yes.
Great. Good news, guys.
If you have the phone number, would you give them a call on them?
No. Next time up in the new business is discussion of the ideal candidate for city manager recruitment. Well, I'm going to start with public comment. And Andrea Evans wants to speak about that. We'll talk about the new city manager.
Hey, Council. Andrea Adams. I know we've been on Main Street in Phoenix. And I was just reviewing the city manager position description. I think I was going to be discussing this. And one thing that I felt like was missing, but I was hoping that you would consider including in your discussion, is under the essential duties and responsibilities, is some language regarding the importance of the city manager in dealing and including the local business owners, basically some kind of language that would talk about the importance of the businesses that exist here already, and that I ask that basically Phoenix, you guys prioritize for them improving the relationship between City Hall and the local businesses, as well as just the ease of use in general between local businesses and Phoenix Hall, City Hall and local businesses. Things like having request forms, some basic policy and procedure things could make it a lot easier just when we're interacting down there and trying to get things done with the staff. So that was my comment on that.
Thank you. So, Mr. Mayor, if I may, I'm sure unless there's someone else who wants to speak.
There is someone. We're talking about the city manager's watching, right?
We are.
Okay. My name is Kenneth Chard. I'm live at 230 Jurid Court. I have a lot of experience at government employment. I started out at age 23 as a federal agency's national recruitment officer. Later on, I ran two embassies, including the most difficult one even running over a few years. Where nothing is good, though all the employees are ruled by socialism, the money is worthless, and trying to get any work out of them is almost impossible. The one thing I found, especially in small towns like this, everybody gets really impressed with credentials. You know, if you've gone down and had your ticket punched and, you know, you've got all sorts of degrees and stuff like that. I've got the equivalent of 6 master's degrees, including ones in leadership and administration. But as a matter of fact, the skills that I brought to leading various very difficult federal operations came with me. It had nothing to do with my training, almost nothing that I did. When I negotiated the first successful treaty with the Barbary Pirates, that wasn't something I learned. Classes. And so what you've got to, it really doesn't matter that the person that doesn't even need to have a degree if they are an effective leader and effective manager. One of the things you need to do is not only, if you want to pull the citizens, that's fine, but what you really want to do is you really want to find out from the city staff what they want to have as a manager. Because let me tell you something, you know, you're, as a city manager, you know, you're basically held hostage by your staff. If they love you, they're going to do a good job for you, and they're going to do a good job for the city. If they hate you, then everything's going to fall apart. And so it's very important that that you call the city staff and find out particularly what they need and what their problem is with, and that sort of thing. It's one of the reasons why I suggested quite some time ago that a management audit be performed so you can find out sort of if there are any problem areas and that sort of thing. Well, you can figure out, along with the use of the management canvas and stuff like that,
the one minute solve some of those problems.
I'm sorry?
The 1 minute solution.
Well, that's all. That's all right.
That's it.
Yeah. Now, if you have any other questions, okay. I'll be more than happy to answer them, but I'm sure if I do not.
Okay, you get to the end of the minute to fire like.
No, that's it. Okay. I mean, if you have any other questions, I have a lot of experience in this. I've hired hundreds of people for high-level jobs and stuff like that. And I've run very complex operations. I renovated the office that regulated the International Set of Arms. And boy, you tell me that's difficult. That was a combination of law enforcement and licensing. And you take in Algeria, I had to fight terrorists. So I do have a lot of experience. So you can ask me if you want to ask me, because you know I can be very useful.
Thanks for your help.
Yeah. I would ask the individual to leave the information, whether it's in them, because we're going to be forming panels for you to get along. And one of them is have citizens be a part of that panel. Mm-hmm. So.
You have my email address. Let's go ahead and email me with your contact information.
Okay, I sent you several emails and never replied. So, you know.
Hey!
is it the email that was listed in the newsletter?
Yes. I'll get the newsletter already. You got the newsletter already. Great.
No, so, the last newsletter. I haven't seen the new newsletter.
All right. That's just relevant.
It's.
Go ahead and write down your phone number on the phone. So you can tell us.
541
okay.
306 1356.
Thanks, Ken.
Let me start this part of the discussion. I wonder if it would be helpful to have our city manager talk a little bit about what traditionally this kind of hiring process looks like, or what process you're outlining before we talk about qualification.
I was definitely planning to discuss it. So let me first say, we're not here tonight to talk about the position description. The position description matters that was just updated last year. I haven't really looked at it in depth. But the position description is basically what we use to evaluate resumes when they come in and determine whether someone who is applying for the position meets the minimum qualifications. A lot of people look good on paper. A lot of people don't have the minimum qualifications on paper. So we use the position description to screen people in and out. What I want to talk to you about tonight is the ideal candidate profile. Because once you have identify the people that you want to talk to, you want to have in place that ideal candidate profile that says, we're going to develop interview questions to determine whether or not the person we're talking to meets that profile. It also tells people who may have the academic background or the years of experience or who have held the job titles that you're looking for. It tells them, forget about your education, forget about your experience. There are certain qualities that we're looking for in a city manager, and this is what we're looking for. And we're going to test you during the interview process to see whether or not you meet these characteristics, because that's the person that we want to hire. Typically, in this type of process, we're going to wind up at the end of it with a group of candidates, probably a relatively small number, any one of whom could do the job. But the person who's best for the job is the one who comes closest to matching the ideal candidate. And that's why we need to do that. So in terms of process, I will lay all this out and have it probably for the May 1st meeting, have a timeline and a process for your thought. What I'm thinking right now is at your next meeting, I will come back to you with a draft ideal candidate profile based on the input that I get tonight. I think you should take public testimony on that. Once you adopt that, at your May 1st meeting, you need to adopt a resolution and hold a public hearing on the qualifications that you're looking for in a city manager. The reason you need to do that is it gives you the option of doing the interviews in executive session. You can't do the interviews in executive session unless you have given the public an opportunity to review the criteria that you will use in making the decision. I would envision as soon as possible after the that May 1st meeting, advertising positions at a minimum on the ICMA website, the OCCMA website. There was a group called Emerging Local Government Leaders, and I don't believe the city was last time they hired them. Also, California Association of Cities, I don't recall them, the Public Safety League World of Cities, who Washington is. And you could go as far as Washington. As I mentioned when I spoke to the council a couple of weeks ago, extremely well connected in this business, that there are people I already have in mind that I want to reach out to directly and say, you really ought to take a look at this position and see if I can do some direct recruitment. There's a lag time between the time you place the ad and the time the ad appears, so I expect the ads will probably start running about mid-May. I would suggest advertising for at least 4 weeks, so you have all of your resumes in by mid-June, or if you want to go longer, you have them at the end of June. At that point, I would develop a system for you, a rating system, whereby you can evaluate all the resumes that come in, see who the highest ranked candidates are, invite them for an interview. If all goes well, you could probably do interviews and meetings with the public in early August. And my hope is that we would have an offer to someone that is accepted by the first week of September. We're hiring someone who is already employed. They're probably going to want to give their employer at least 30 days notice. Best case scenario, you have my services through the end of September. I'd really prefer you not have a gap between me and the company city manager. It would be ideal for me to be able to spend a couple of days with whoever you hire and have some better relationship. Again, I have the ability to flex my hours so that I can extend my employment period if necessary, but again, I can't go beyond 1,039 hours, so you can work on that as the time goes. So, any questions about what I'm thinking in terms of the timeline?
When you get that draft together for the council to look at, can you get that on the website in good time?
Oh, absolutely.
Since we want to get public input so they have a chance to be able to get over that. I don't think we just put a newsletter out, so we don't know if you have time for it.
In the newsletter, I did mention that we are open to public comment.
Yeah, but they don't have the criteria.
I said, but it's in there, it'll be on the website.
Yeah,
people have covered that, I hope.
I brought some things for you to look at, and I wish I had sent this out to you in advance of the meeting. I just pulled this off the internet today. These are some recruitment brochures. The first one that I passed around to you is actually the recruitment brochure for the Fire District 5 Chief. And you can see at the top of the brochure, they have the ideal candidate profile. The ideal candidate profile is much different than the position description. Down below, they have the background and education. And background and education are basically saying, this is how we're going to screen resumes. This is what we're looking for. Then in the ideal candidate description and down at the bottom, the skills, experience, ability, they're saying, this is what we're going to judge you on when we get to talk to you. And you can see that contrast even more starkly in this other recruitment brochure, which is done by Bob Murray Associates for the City of California, where they've got basic position description, very bureaucratic reading position description on the left, and then the ideal candidate description on the right, where they say, okay, forget about the position description. These are the qualities and the personal characteristics that we're looking for in a new city manager. That's going to be different for every jurisdiction because the issues and the dynamics are different in every jurisdiction. So my question for you then is if you can just start brainstorming a little bit about what are the characteristics that you would like to see in your ideal city manager.
Let me just say that one of the things that we're going to have to do, like Jim mentioned during our council leadership meeting, that we're going to need to, I believe, increase the salary that we're willing to pay the city manager in order to increase the candidate pool. Last time was 92.5. I think we've got to crack the six-figure number and give a range of maybe $10,000-$15,000 in order to increase that candidate pool. It's important. But that's it. Why are we there?
Just a comment on that salary range. It was set because we were going on for somebody with a prior city manager. And we're open for someone that has city manager experience.
I would say about a city manager experience, at least someone that's been a department head in the city or county, at least.
Is that a conversation that's going to come to council? Whether or not to increase the pay range?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. That all inside the thing I'm talking about now for the council, but yeah.
It's not on our agenda. I was just curious if it's going to come to us.
Yes.
Definitely would like to have someone who has a lot of HR experience. Anymore.
Yeah. And that used to come to being a senior manager. The reason I worry about the city managers is you block this 10% that we see, it's that 90% can get the city in a lot of trouble. And even as a department head, it's still fairly narrow in the responsibilities of the overall city. And I just really feel uncomfortable. We've gone that way without city management experiences, and it hasn't worked out very well in certain areas. And I'd really like to see city management. And as you can see, the comments and everything that Dave's given to us is much more mature information as far as city management goes.
We also talked about meeting assistant assistant
right.
Like a large department.
Well, eventually we could work responsibility. You mentioned about input or teamwork. Would you be willing to canvass the employees of the city to get out of their input?
Sure.
Not names attached to it, but just what they see, what we want in their loss.
Sure, absolutely.
And I think that'd be important to the council.
I would like to see somebody who's process oriented. There's a lot of good language in some of these materials. Thank you for providing them. Somebody who's honest, ethical, and trustworthy, who can encourage transparent relationships. I'm just taking it directly out of here with all elected officials and communicate openly and directly with council. I think communication is absolutely key. An ability to manage and maintain good relationships with staff, business partners, community members. Oh, and I love this, that's in here, proven consensus builder. I love that.
Understand the rules of order.
Well, exactly, order rules, but that's what I mean by process oriented. Somebody who understands the rules and will help us make sure that we're doing it right.
They need to be an excellent communicator, better listener than speaker.
To dovetail off of the staff relationships, I want to see some that you can't tell them how to manage, but at the very beginning, I'd like to have them agree with the process of wherever a city manager will allow their department heads to speak with city councilors and the mayor. Communicate by email just as long as the city manager is in the loop. Chris Clayton does it over in Central Point. I really respect. Dave has just instituted that kind of policy and makes a more open environment. So just you can't tell them how to manage, but that might be a recommendation.
Is there feedback from, is there like a 360 degree review process for the city manager to get feedback from staff for improvement? Where it's not a one way evaluation, there's an evaluation of the chain also.
That's the council's call. You need to establish the evaluation method.
In the past, we have had the staff evaluations go to the council. But that's the way we always done the peer evaluation as well as the council.
I can tell you, I personally have always invited staff evaluation. The job I do it. In terms of a formal 360, I've never been a big fan of 360 reviews that go outside the organization because you're asking people who may not have a whole lot of interaction with the city manager to evaluate city manager behavior of the yes or no.
Yeah. Just with staff, you know, direct contact staff.
Stuart mentioned the lots of human resource experience. I like that. Can we add to that staff leadership experience? That's why I was talking about going to the management of a city manager. When you get a department head, it's very limited. If you get to a city manager, if you're familiar with the training for a city manager and everything else, and there's a lot of extra training besides the college training, that covers all the various departments of the city, so they understand what needs to go on and what their department head should be doing. So I really want to look at those credentials. They're very important. So much in planning, so much in public works, I think that the city manager is an expert in it, but they need to understand what is expected from those departments, and when he's not getting it, or she's not getting it, what has to be done to correct that.
So, is that any comments?
I was looking at this one, kind of processing it. I think all the things I like to see are probably written on this page more than another. And they cover the kind of things I think we're talking about here. It's a good starting point. I mean, we can tweak this a little bit, but I think it's got the qualities that we're looking for in the human being.
Hey, can I ask, how does the council feel about spending a lot of money to create a recruitment brochure so that when a candidate goes to the ad, instead of seeing just one of what's probably dozens and dozens of ads for a city manager, and says, you know, we're looking for a dynamic, creative, honest, ethical, transparent leader. Click here for more information about what a wonderful thing it is to work for the city of Phoenix. And they go to a recruitment brochure that looks like this, that has some photos of the community and information about the community as well as about the job. Remember, when you're hiring a city manager, you're not just hiring the city manager in many cases, you're hiring the city manager's family. They may be moving a spouse and kids here. So they really need to be sold on the community and not just on the job.
I think that's fine with me. I mean, depends on what you mean by little. You know, if you're talking a couple thousand dollars.
I wouldn't spend more than a couple thousand dollars, that's for sure.
Good. We can approve it tonight. We put just the upper end limit on it.
So it's just...
Oh, the amount.
Yeah. It's just...
I would just like to see the ad before it goes out.
Okay.
Via email or whatnot.
So you just want to hire someone, a graphic artist, to make things of that nature?
Yeah, or, you know, I could talk to Wendy Brown, who did this brochure. She's located in Central Point.
Uh-huh.
And see if she'd want to do a brochure for us.
Shouldn't be too hard.
Nothing to make it there. Make a motion to authorize the city manager to go out and prepare one for us.
Second.
Okay, want to put a price limit on that?
That was moved in second.
I think it's mine.
More discussion?
There's a $75 limit on the day.
One thing you will learn about me is I've been accused many times in the past of being too cheap, and I prefer to think I'm frugal, not cheap. But believe me, I'm not going to go out and blow a lot of money on a recruiting brochure. What I have so far is you would prefer someone with prior city manager experience, or at least high level department head experience. Someone with HR and staff leadership experience, someone who's process-oriented, honest, ethical, transparent, relationships with the council, staff, business partners, and the community. Someone who, I would say it's a plus if you get someone who understands Oregon public meeting and public records law.
Yeah.
Someone who's an excellent communicator with superior listening skills. So that's what I have so far from the discussion.
At least an open door policy like you have is between staff and the council and mayor. So why don't we go ahead and do the roll call? We can move on to something else.
Councilor Baker?
Yes.
Councilor Snyder?
Yes.
Councilor Shunk?
Yes.
Councilor Westover?
Yes.
Councilor Warren?
Yes.
Councilor Sophie?
Yes.
If I may, when you develop this, will it be something that can be adapted to department heads if we lose one of those eventually? So that it could be more generalized and, you know, pickers and whatever.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we'll retain rights to it so we can have an initial copy and alter it if we need to.
Should we have it?
Okay, just checking.
Yes. We own it.
More discussion next?
Anything more from us, or we need to move on?
I think we can move on. If anyone thinks of anything else, if something comes to you at 2 o'clock in the morning and you think, oh, I should have added that to the actual candidate program.
Email it to me today, yeah.
Can we just see a draft when it's available and then maybe we can give a few thoughts and feedback via email?
Great.
Thank you.
Can I ask for a quick clarification real quick on something else?
Sure.
Because I'm the new guy.
Yep.
The consent calendar is approved in one fell swoop, right?
It is.
Okay.
Except for things
unless we pull something up. So there's two members of the attendees. I just want to make clear that you voted yes on this makes sense.
Yeah. They're very concerned. So I just thanks for that personal sidebar there.
Yeah.
But
sure,
okay,
we're not happy there. That's important.
Yeah. Swing sets approved. Okay.
Thanks, Mike. Let's move on to item.
You have personal interest in that one?
I do. Well, sorry, I was coerced by them. I don't know if that.
Once you declared it, now it's okay.
Let's move on to 9C, student loan cancellation policy. I think one person in the public want to get a comment on it. Doing great.
My question was just under the fiscal impact, I was just confused if the entire cost is $1,140 per, or if it's $1,140 plus the 4 street times $80 a piece, including the staff time, or if it was then those two amounts plus the staff time. So if you just please clarify what the total fiscal impact would be per month.
So just to answer that question, since you brought it right up, the 4 street signs are required. It says also at a cost of 80 each, and there are 4 of them, so $320 more. Total cost is $1,460. There have been requests in the past, as well as more recently, for the installation of speed humps. And as far as I could see, there wasn't any real process involved with how you determine what goes where with respect to the installation on the city right away. I think it's important to try to put some parameters on this type of development, since it is a physical obstruction in your right of way, and it is something that inhibits traffic flow. There's no two ways about it. That's what a speed hump is. There have been successful installations and unsuccessful installations, some due to the material that's put in and the type of speed hump that was installed, and some due to the characteristics of the roadway. They're not all well suited for speed humps. In fact, I rarely have pursued them as an individual installation. I've rather installed them as a part of a larger overall traffic calming program within a street system or community. Speed humps do a couple different things other than just slowing down vehicles. As it is an obstruction in your traveled way, it's not uncommon to see trips diverted away from the speed hump, and that displaces those vehicles onto another adjacent roadway. Typically the next block removed adjacent to where the speed hump is located, and it also creates a potential hazard for traffic flow, because it is, again, a physical impediment for the roadway. People that are unfamiliar with the roadways sometimes find it to be an unexpected impediment, and so there are oftentimes complaints about that aspect of it. And it also makes noise, and in a residential area, you will hear noise from speed bump impacts. However, placed correctly, obviously, they're successful and manageable, because an awful lot of communities utilize this type of installation for primarily any speed control. And sometimes, as a diversionary tactic, you move vehicles away from travel, a route that's being traveled as a pass-through roadway rather than as a roadway that services the immediately adjacent residents. So we put together a two-page summary that was attached to this that describes in some detail how I would see the speed hump installation request going forward. We currently have an encroachment permit application. I would suggest that that's the way that it comes into the city, and that that request be made by the individuals or typically the property owners along the street segment that's going to be affected. The highlights of the form or the policy include getting a 70% concurrence from the affected property owners within the block that the speed hump where the installation would occur. And that would include the corner lots at whatever block the speed hump goes in. Typically it goes in mid-block, as well centered between stop signs as possible, is the typical installation you see. In the case of a longer roadway segment, you would have to look for the intersecting blocks as being, in my mind, the contributing participants in the for authorizing the installation. Very, very important to get property owner consensus on these types of installations. It's not always as attractive as people think it is. So in that regard, we've asked for 70% concurrence for the affected property owners. There is a clause in here about, in case of cul-de-sac, the affected property owners include those properties around the entire cul-de-sac and the properties in the corner lots. It's because the people at the head of the cul-de-sac, even though the speed bump won't be in front of their house, they're still going to hold it, you know, twice a day for every trip. I'd only allow them to be installed on roadways classified as local roads. I think putting them on any higher classification road than that is an impediment to travel flow that is not warranted, in my mind. We can't put them on emergency